Please take your Bible and turn to Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. We're studying the things that the Apostle John was shown in a series of visions to share with the followers of Yeshua regarding future events that will suddenly come to pass someday. Not only so we will know what's going to happen, but also to reaffirm our faith if or when we see these things come to pass in our lifetime. Last week we began studying this parenthetical chapter 7 that comes between the 6th and the 7th seals, and we began to look at the 144,000 sealed servants of God. Today we will continue to look at this mysterious group, and we'll consider an aspect that is rarely discussed. And I think you will find it to be a fascinating concept regarding one possible role of the 144,000 in the end times and how it could affect us who are believers in Yeshua. But first, let's briefly and quickly review some of what we learned last week. As John's vision continues at the beginning of chapter 7, he sees four angels who are able and ready to affect the entire earth with winds that represent the destructive forces of God's judgment. And these angels are given that ability and that authority by Yahweh himself. But not just yet. They're holding these winds of judgment back until the time is right. In verse 2, we see that a fifth angel has the seal of God. And seals have long been used since ancient times by kings and property owners to show ownership, to show source, to show authenticity and authority. This angel cries to the four angels, and we see in verse 3 that hurting the earth and the sea and even the trees is their assignment. And we will see this take place when we get to the trumpets in chapter 8. Whatever protection mankind has enjoyed in the past will be removed when the forces of nature are unleashed to deliver God's judgments upon the world. Many people don't realize it, but the Bible clearly shows that God sometimes uses weather and nature and natural disasters as instruments of his judgment. But here in chapter 7, there's a little break in the action, like an intermission in the havoc that is caused by the opening of the sixth seal and the cataclysmic events that follow until this task of sealing certain people is carried out. And these angels are being told to not hurt the earth or the sea or the trees until these servants of God have been sealed in their foreheads, apparently for protection from God's judgment. And then we see in verse 4 that there are exactly 144,000 of these servants of God who are sealed by the angels. Last week we began to look at the questions of who these 144,000 might be and what will they be doing. In verses 5 through 8 we're told that they were sealed 12,000 from each one of the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, 12 times 12,000 is 144,000. And that is a number that is said to represent completeness or perfection. But contrary to what many of us have heard in the past, I don't believe that these 144,000 are symbolic of the Gentile Christian church. They're Israelites! And it's possible that some Hebrew roots believers who are biblical Israelites, at least in a spiritual sense, could possibly be included because some of us may be physical descendants of Jacob without knowing it. The 144,000 are commonly thought of as Jewish witnesses for Christ who will somehow spark a gigantic end times revival. Although no such revival is prophesied anywhere in the Bible. The 144,000 are never even described as witnesses. And rather than a revival, the Bible actually predicts a huge apostasy, a massive falling away of those who claim to be believers, but who fall prey to false teachers and false prophets and descriptive signs and wonders and delusion. There is simply no evidence at all anywhere in the Bible to support the notion that the 144,000 will be witnesses to others. Now, part of their assignment may be to do what ancient Hebrew groomsmen did at ancient Hebrew weddings, and they still do. Last week, we considered this suggestion that chapter 7 introduces us to more of the participants in the future wedding of the Lamb. And we already met the father of the groom, Yahweh, and the groom himself, Yeshua, back in chapters 4 and 5. And now, maybe we're meeting some more of the participants. And this suggestion comes from the book Lost in Translation, Volume 2, by John Klein and Adam Spears, who lead a messianic group in Oregon. Now, one important step in the ancient Hebrew betrothal sequence would be for the groom to pick out his groomsmen. As he goes away to prepare a place for his bride, he would select his groomsmen and give them the authority to act on his behalf. And there were certain characteristics of these groomsmen. Hebrew grooms always selected unmarried virgin men. And these men always came directly from the groom's own people. And the groomsmen could also be called watchmen or bond servants who followed and served the groom and helped him prepare for the wedding. The Bible never calls these 144,000 in Revelation groomsmen because that's a relatively modern term. But it is fascinating to compare what they do to the traditional role and function of groomsmen at Hebrew weddings, both in the preparations and during the ceremony itself. And Revelation chapter 7 doesn't tell us that much about this, but we'll see more of that in chapter 14. We'll discuss those things when we get there. But we can say that the 144,000 are from the groom's family. They're descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob with very specific responsibilities. They're not symbolic figures representing another group of people. And the things that the 144,000 are instructed to do in the book of Revelation seem to correspond to some of the parts of the traditional role of groomsmen in the ancient Hebrew wedding. Now, one other possible role of the 144,000 is seen by some in the listing of these groups of 12,000, suggesting a possible census with military objectives, perhaps as the army of Yeshua when he returns in chapter 19 to do final battle with his enemies. And it has been said that 144,000 is a well-known Jewish symbol of the army that will accompany the Messiah in a violent uprising against Israel's enemies to restore Israel to its place as a sovereign nation. Now, before I share with you another fascinating possibility, a fascinating possible role or task of the 144,000, it'll be real helpful if I first give you some background information. You know, there's some things that we might hear that don't mean what they could and should because we didn't understand something else first. The whole Bible makes a lot more sense if you understand these concepts. So I want to spend just a few minutes talking about the two houses of Israel and Judah and the future ingathering of those who have been scattered, who are also known as the exiles, and the future of God's people. Now, if we base our expectations of future events on a literal interpretation of Scripture, rather than basing our expectations on the teachings that are presented by most of the teachers and preachers in churchianity, we will not expect to go live in heaven forever after we die. Even if we really believe in God and really believe in Yeshua and really do our best to live godly lives, we won't expect to go live in heaven forever, because that's not what the Bible teaches. Scripture teaches that the Messiah will return one day to establish a literal, physical kingdom of God on the earth. And on earth with him is where his followers will spend eternity. The establishment of his kingdom and our journey to be part of it when he returns is a fascinating topic. But before we can begin to comprehend the process, we need to understand a little history first, or else it just won't make sense. And that's why there are so many wrong ideas out there, is because people don't understand the history and the background. So here we go. This is important stuff that we all need to understand, and many of you already know these things, but I just want to make sure we all do. Ancient Israel consisted of 12 tribes with individual territories, plus the tribe of Levi that didn't own any land. Now, Israel was at its peak during the reigns of King David and his son King Solomon. And Solomon was blessed with divine wisdom from God, and he constructed a magnificent temple. And he expanded Israel's influence worldwide. But Solomon messed up. He married foreign wives and was drawn into their pagan religions. And because of this, God decreed that the nation of Israel would be divided. And he promised to give Solomon's servant Jeroboam the 10 northern tribes. Only Judah, which included the small territory of Benjamin, would remain with Solomon's son Rehoboam. And this division took place around the year 931 BC. Now, the tribal territories were allotted by God himself and were assigned to each tribe by Judah. But rather than focusing on the individual territories, the point that I want to focus on right now is that the nation was divided into two separate kingdoms, or houses. The northern kingdom kept the name of Israel and was also known as Ephraim or Ephraim, which is the most prominent northern tribe. It was also known by the name of Joseph. And the southern kingdom was known by its principal tribe, Judah. So what was one nation of Israel became a northern kingdom of Israel and a southern kingdom of Judah. And it's clear that the northern kingdom of Israel was separated from the southern kingdom of Judah because of Solomon's idolatry. After Solomon died, Jeroboam assumed power in the northern kingdom of Israel, and he led it into apostasy and idolatry. He established substitute worship for the northern kingdom Israelites with substitute worship centers. He didn't want them going down to Jerusalem and moving back to Judah, so he established alternate worship centers at the cities of Dan and Bethel. And he had altars with golden calves and unauthorized priests and alternate feast dates in the wrong months. Israel, or Ephraim, continued in idolatry for the remainder of its history. And it didn't stop there. As the gospel spread throughout the world in the second and third centuries after Yeshua's life, a similar pattern emerged in the church. Idolatry was introduced with many of the icons of the early church taken directly from pagan religions and adapted to Christian saints and customs and worship. The seventh-day Sabbath and the annual feasts that are commanded by Yahweh in the Bible were replaced with a Sunday Sabbath and Christmas and Easter and a whole liturgical calendar of holidays that you will never find mentioned or celebrated in the Bible. And several of these holidays coincided with existing pagan feasts that were just Christianized. And just as the northern kingdom of Israel, Ephraim, was later dispersed or scattered among the nations, So also was this practice of religious people attempting to worship Yahweh using their own days and their own symbols and their own celebrations that were adopted from pagan cultures. Now, the prophets referred to this northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah also as houses. Many passages speak of the southern kingdom as the house of Judah. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Zechariah spoke many times to the house of Judah and to the house of Israel. And sometimes the phrase, both houses of Israel, or the whole house of Israel is used, referring to both at the same time. And often the single term Ephraim is used in Scripture to refer to the northern house or northern kingdom of Israel. The northern kingdom and the southern kingdom remained separate political entities for the next 200 years, although there was some intermingling between them. Now in 722 BC, the Assyrian Empire attacked the northern kingdom and scattered many, if not most, of the Israelites into other areas in the world. And they brought in other people to live there, and there was more intermingling and more intermarriage. And since that time, the northern kingdom of Israel, or Ephraim, for the most part, has been scattered among the nations of the world. Now, fast forward 150 years. Jerusalem was attacked by the Babylonian Empire, and the southern kingdom of Judah was taken captive in 586 BC and exiled to Babylon. Now, some of them returned after 70 years of captivity. But during that time, God gave a prophecy to the prophet Daniel detailing two events: the coming of a prophesied Messiah and their end as a nation. And both prophecies were fulfilled just as God had said they would be. Yeshua the Messiah came, and he was crucified, buried, and resurrected just outside the city of Jerusalem. And in the year 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans. And by the year 135 AD, the southern kingdom of Judah and really the entire nation of Israel pretty much ceased to exist as a separate entity, and as both the Israelites and the Jews had become exiles. Now, here's the part that many believers aren't familiar with. What I've said up to now is pretty common knowledge in well-established history, and many Christian teachers and preachers and scholars get that part of it. But they're less familiar, especially the typical Christian in the pews of churches, is typically less familiar with what I'm going to share with you now. Yahweh says numerous times in Scripture that one day he will regather the exiles in the last days and reform a unified nation. When Messiah returns, the faithful exiles of Israel and Judah will be gathered together from all over the world and returned to the promised land. This gathering together is spoken of many, many times in Scripture. And it's one of the major expectations of the Messiah, along with the defeat of God's enemies. For example, Ezekiel chapter 37 speaks of the dry, dead bones of Israel living again, and two sticks representing Israel and Judah becoming one. He says the stick of Joseph, which is in the hand of Ephraim, representing the tribes of Israel, the northern kingdom, will once again become one with the stick of Judah, reunited under one king. In the end times, as the nations who come against Israel are judged and punished, faithful believers from all of the 12 tribes of Israel, as well as the faithful former Gentiles who have been grafted in and adopted into the family of God, will all be reunited as one nation, one people, the Israel of God, with Messiah Yeshua ruling and reigning from the throne of David in Jerusalem. Now, this prophecy of the literal, physical reunification of Israel has never been completely fulfilled. The southern kingdom, Judah, the Jewish people, even though they ceased to exist as a nation in the second century AD, they have still pretty much maintained their cultural and ethnic and religious heritage and identity while being hated and despised and persecuted for over 2,000 years. And since the nation of Israel was established in 1948, some of them have gone back to the promised land. I think it's fair to look at that as some of the initial steps of this regathering. But the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom, Israel or Ephraim, they're still scattered among the nations. They are the multitude of nations that were promised to Abraham. And they're also known as the fullness of the Gentiles. Most of them have no idea who they are, but God does. And He has promised to take them from the nations and unite them with their brothers and sisters and bring them together as one nation under Messiah Yeshua. And this gathering and this uniting includes both houses, the house of Judah and the house of Joseph or Ephraim or Israel, along with any Gentiles who have joined them by repentance and faith in Yeshua. So, either at or just prior to the return of Messiah Yeshua, the scattered houses of Judah and Israel or Ephraim will be reunited under one king that Ezekiel calls David in Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 24. Now that's symbolic language. King David was already dead. But he was talking about a son or a descendant of David, referring to the King of Kings, Yeshua the Messiah. And this final ingathering of the exiles is described in several passages, and I just want to share a few of them with you to make sure that you get this really solidly, okay? For example, in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 12, the Bible says, "He shall set up an ensign for the nations and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth." And then Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 3 says, "Lo, the days come, says Yahweh, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, says Yahweh, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it." And then in Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 37, he says, "Behold, I will gather them out of all countries where I have driven them in my anger and in my fury and in great wrath, and I will bring them again unto this place, and I will cause them to dwell safely." And then some passages in Ezekiel. "Thus says the Lord Yahweh, when I shall have gathered the house of Israel from the people among whom they are scattered, and shall be sanctified in them in the sight of the heathen, then they shall dwell in their land that I have given to my servant Jacob." And then in Ezekiel 34, beginning in verse 12, he says, "As a shepherd seeks out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are scattered, so will I seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all places where they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day." In the cloudy and dark day refers to the day of the Lord, the end of the times of God's judgment. "And I will bring them out from among the people and gather them from the countries and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountain of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country." Ezekiel 36, verse 24, he says, "For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land." And in Ezekiel 37, beginning in verse 21, Yahweh says, "I will take the children of Israel from among the heathen where they be gone and will gather them on every side and bring them into their own land. And I will make them one nation in the land upon the mountains of Israel, and one king shall be king to them all, And they shall no more be two nations, neither shall they be divided into two kingdoms anymore at all. I don't know about you, but I never did hear about this in the Baptist church. But this is a really big deal. And there are many, many more passages that speak about this reuniting. The restoration of the whole house of Israel by gathering the exiles from all over the world is essential to the gospel message of the kingdom. And it affects us all, regardless of our heritage. When Messiah returns and establishes his kingdom on the earth, the two houses, Israel and Judah, will be reunited as one kingdom, one nation, God's people, the Israel of God, made up of all true, genuine, faithful, obedient followers of Yeshua.
Hallelujah.
Now the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 31 and in Hebrews chapter 8 that God's new covenant, which actually should be translated as renewed covenant, was promised to who? To the house of Israel and to the house of Judah, not to Gentiles. It seems that some Christians have a misunderstanding that they're almost proud to be participating in the new covenant of God, but they don't want anything to do with Israel or Jews or... That doesn't work. In order to participate in the new covenant, we must belong either to the house of Israel or to the house of Judah, either as a physical descendant or as someone who is grafted in. And either way, faith in Messiah and repentance from sin, those two things are required to be a biblical Israelite and a participant in this covenant. Yeshua says in John chapter 10, verses 16 and 17, that he gave his life for the purpose of taking two sheepfolds and making them one. He says in verse 11 that he is the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. Now here's something else that most Christians don't know. The reuniting of the exiles of Israel and Judah is one of the reasons that Yeshua came and died. This is confirmed in John chapter 11. This is not just me saying this. I'm going to show you a Bible passage that says this. This is confirmed in a prophecy that was given by Caiaphas, who was the high priest at the time. This was at a meeting of the chief priests and Pharisees. It begins in John chapter 11, verse 49. He says, "And one of them, named Caiaphas, being the high priest that same year, said unto them, You know nothing at all, nor consider that it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people, and that the whole nation perish not. And this spoke he, not of himself, but being the high priest that year, he prophesied, the Bible says, that Yeshua should die for that nation, and not for that nation only, but that also he should gather together in one the children of God that were scattered abroad."
Glory to God.
Hallelujah. So the divided nation of Israel, including the exiles, will once again become one. Yeshua died to pay for the sins of that nation and to physically gather them from their exile in the nations of the world where they have been scattered. Paul teaches in Romans chapter 11 that Gentiles, those who aren't Jewish or Israelite by birth, become believers and are grafted into the olive tree that represents biblical Israel. And he teaches us in Ephesians chapters 2 and 3 and in Galatians 3 that Gentiles who were aliens of the commonwealth of Israel, when they become believers, they become fellow citizens with the Jewish saints in the household of God. partakers of the covenants of promise, and fellow heirs of what was promised to Abraham. Those are the phrases that Paul uses. Now, I'm not paraphrasing. That's his language. This is part of the reason why all believers in Yeshua, regardless of our physical heritage, are part of Israel, at least spiritually. Therefore, the teaching and instructions to Israel in the Bible are for all believers, and not just for the natural Jews and Israelites, who are not even necessarily included in the Israel of God. Paul says not all of Israel is Israel. The Jews who reject Yeshua, they got a problem. But all believers are part of Israel. And some of us may be physical descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob without even knowing it. Now, I want to be real clear here. I do not believe or teach that all who believe in Yeshua are physical descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Some people who object to two-house teaching say that two-house advocates claim that all Christians are physical Israelites, whether they know it or not. But that's not true. That's a false claim. None of the two-house teachers that I know and respect teach this. And in most cases, it's impossible to know for sure anyway. There are some DNA tests that can inform us of certain markers that might tie us to a Hebrew lineage. And God did say that the descendants of Joseph's son Ephraim would become a multitude of nations. But even if we are unable to verify that our ancestry includes any of the 12 tribes of Israel, believers in Yeshua are still biblical Israelites. Now, some of us may be Jewish, some of us may be connected to one of the other Israelite tribes, and many believers won't be connected physically at all to any of the 12 tribes of Israel. But ultimately, that doesn't matter. Because God's plan of salvation is for all of the nations who join His people, not just the physical descendants of Jacob. Isaiah chapter 56 tells us that anyone has always been able to join with Israel and worship the God of Israel and keep His commandments and enjoy the blessings. And by the way, they weren't observing the commandments to be saved. It's what they did after they got saved. The nation of Israel was given the Torah at Mount Sinai after they had been delivered, after they had come into relationship with God. He gave them the commandments and the Torah to show them how to live. My spiritual identity and my salvation are not based on my ancestry or on the possibility of being a physical descendant of Jacob, but on what Yeshua did for me and on my faith and my repentance. Amen. Whether we're physically connected or not, we are spiritually connected through Yeshua. Now, why does this matter? What's so important about all this? It's because Israel, biblical Israel, is God's vessel to try to lead the whole world to salvation in Him. We are to reflect His light and His love to those around us. Our primary goals should be seeing people receive salvation in Yeshua and being born again, and then making sure that they get correct, accurate Bible teaching that instructs them to live by the principles in the Torah. And there is a revival burning among Christians worldwide as the Holy Spirit is awakening them and drawing them back to the Hebrew roots of biblical faith. And we need to be prepared to help those who are making that transition. Today, the God of Israel is gathering Judah, the Jewish people, the descendants of the southern kingdom, together with Israel, the physical descendants of the northern kingdom who are scattered all over the world, along with the grafted in, adopted, non-Jewish and non-Israelite believers who were formerly Gentiles, as one body of people in Messiah Yeshua. God only has one group of people. The people of the Israel of God, which is made up of believers from the tribes of the house of Judah and the tribes of the house of Israel and their companions, the Bible says. Gentiles who believe and join the people of God, just like the mixed multitude did in the Exodus out of Egypt. Biblically speaking, there is no separate entity of a Gentile church. God calls and expects every believer, all of biblical Israel, to uphold and follow His Torah. It's our covenant document. You might say it's our constitution. Our citizenship in the Commonwealth of Israel and our obedience to Torah should be the natural results of our identity in Messiah, which gives us the right and the responsibility to obey and live by the commandments of God. And as part of Israel, we're going to be participating in some of those end times prophecies that relate to Israel, including the regathering, the reunification, and the restoration of all Israel, including Judah, Israel, and the grafted in former Gentiles from all over the world. Paul tells us in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, that our gathering together unto Yeshua will be in the day of Christ, which is another term for the day of the Lord. This is a reference to the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel. The Bible tells us in various places about some of the things that are going to be happening in the world in the end of days. Things that we can look for and recognize that prophecies are being fulfilled. The prophets tell us that it's going to happen at a time when the nations of the world come together to divide the land of Israel, according to Joel chapter 3, verse 2, and to divide the city of Jerusalem, Zechariah 14, verse 2. And we actually have seen the beginning of the fulfillment of this prophecy through the efforts of the nations of the world, through UN resolutions, to seek to establish a Palestinian state which would divide Israel and Jerusalem. And when this happens, it will result in the judgment of the nations, including the United States of America. And in judging the nations, the Bible emphasizes the fall of Babylon and the Babylonian system. And there will be financial judgment upon the whole world, worse than anything we have ever seen. And there will be war between the nations. And it will be while the nations are being judged that the God of Israel is going to begin the process to gather His people back to Israel and to fulfill the prophecy of Ezekiel 37, uniting the 12 tribes of Israel. The uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel is associated with the Messianic era when Yeshua rules and reigns and the establishment of biblical Zion. Now, how do we know when this gathering from the nations of the world is going to take place for the purpose of uniting the 12 tribes of Israel? The word Zion in Hebrew is Sion. It's Strong's number 6726, and it's spelled Zadi, Yod, Vav, or Wad, depending on how you want to say it, Nun. This Hebrew word has the same exact letters as the Hebrew word Zion, Strong's number 6725, which means sign. Zion and Zion have the same letters, and Zion means a sign. That's the basic meaning of the word family that these words come from. That family of words is all related to a sign. The establishment of Zion is a sign to the whole world, to the 12 tribes of Israel. But specifically, we're told in Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 15 to 22, that it is a sign that Rachel can quit weeping for her children because they're going to return to their own border, to the promised land. And this passage mentions Ephraim by name. Now check this out. An English version of Zion is spelled S-C-I-O-N. And in horticulture or gardening, guess what that means? Grafting.
What is it?
Grafting. According to Romans 11, biblical grafting is adding Gentiles to Israel, like grafting a wild olive branch to an olive tree, which is part of the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel. It's associated with the grafting or bringing together the northern kingdom with the southern kingdom, Israel or Ephraim with Judah. Now, here's a very important principle. Bible prophecy not only foretells future events, but it also frequently sets a pattern of fulfillment. A pattern of fulfillment. Some prophecies are fulfilled more than one time at various levels. It's not unusual to see a fulfillment at one level during Bible times or later, while also pointing to another ultimate fulfillment in the last days that still follows the pattern of the earlier fulfillment. Now, Jeremiah 16 compares the gathering of God's people in the end times from among all the nations of the world to the Exodus when he brought them out of Egypt. This refers to the gathering of the exiles. All the biblical Israelites from among all the nations where we have been scattered and returning us to the promised land where we will live under the rule and reign of King Yeshua. This last day's gathering can be called a second greater exodus. And this gathering, this greater exodus, will make a great impact on the rest of the world. At least two passages of Scripture say that it will be so spectacular that no one will even speak of the first Exodus anymore. In Jeremiah 16, beginning in verse 14, the Bible says, "Therefore, behold, the days come, says Yahweh, that it shall no more be said, Yahweh lives that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but Yahweh lives that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the lands where he had driven them. And I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers." This second greater exodus is going to be so fantastic, so incredible, so phenomenal, so unbelievable that people are going to quit talking about the first one out of Egypt. By comparison, it's going to be nothing compared to the next one. And these words are repeated almost word for word in Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 7 and 8. So we have a lot of Bible prophecies yet to be fulfilled that tell us about these things that are going to be happening during the Great Tribulation. The joy of ending the exile is likened to a song. To a song. And it's the task of the Messiah. So, the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel is called the Song of the Lamb in Revelation 15, verse 3. This event is associated with joy and with singing. We read in Jeremiah chapter 31, beginning in verse 7, "For thus says Yahweh, sing with gladness for Jacob, and shout among the chief of the nations. Publish ye, praise ye, and say, Yahweh, save your people, the remnant of Israel. Behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the coasts of the earth." And then the Bible confirms the reason two verses later in Jeremiah 31, verse 10. "Hear the word of Yahweh, O you nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, He that scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as a shepherd does his flock." So this event is likened to a song. And when it happens, it is associated with and linked with Passover. Just as the first Exodus occurred at Passover, if the second greater Exodus follows the pattern, it will also occur at the time of Passover. And just as the people of God were protected during the 10 plagues that took place in Egypt just before they departed, then the people of God will be protected during the judgments of God that take place in the last days after the great tribulation. Just as the Israelites were gathered together immediately before they left Egypt, faithful biblical Israelites in the end of days will also be gathered together. That's what Revelation 12 is about. The woman that has a crown of 12 stars. The 12 stars represent the 12 tribes of Israel united. And this woman gives birth, and it's a time of travail for her, which is a reference to or an allusion to the tribulation period. And when she gives birth, we're told that she flees into the wilderness for protection for 1,260 days. This fleeing into the wilderness is associated with the exiles of Israel returning to the land of Israel. Because when the children of Israel came out of Egypt on their way to the promised land, they also went first into the wilderness. In the same way, faithful biblical Israelites in the last days will go into the wilderness, just as we read in Revelation chapter 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Now in Exodus chapter 19, verses 3 and 4, Yahweh told Moses to tell the children of Israel, "You've seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself." So, as the Israelites came out of Egypt, they went into the wilderness on their way to the promised land. When they left Egypt, Pharaoh and his army followed them, but Pharaoh and his army drowned in the Red Sea. And when Pharaoh and his army drowned in the Red Sea, in Exodus 15, the children of Israel sang a song, and it's called the Song of Moses. Revelation chapter 15, verses 2 and 3 tell us that those who had gotten the victory over the beast and over the beast system sing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. This shows us that the joy of this victory is not only likened unto a song, but also that the song is associated with the Messiah. That's why it's called the Song of the Lamb. So the children of Israel came out of Egypt, and Pharaoh and his army pursued them, but they drowned in the Red Sea because, as it says in Exodus chapter 15, verse 6, it was the right hand of Yahweh that defeated the enemy, Pharaoh and his army, in the Red Sea. We can see a parallel in Revelation 12. When the woman flees into the wilderness for 1,260 days, we see the dragon, which is a reference to the beast and the beast system. And Revelation 12, verse 3 says, "This dragon has 7 heads, 10 horns, and 7 crowns. And verse 17 says that the dragon was angry with the woman and went after her to make war with the remnant of her seed, those who obey God's commandments and have the testimony of Yeshua. But verse 14 says the woman was given 2 wings of a great eagle so she could fly into the wilderness where she is protected for 3.5 years. So even as the children of Israel were delivered as they came out of Egypt, the children of Israel in the last days, who will be returning to the land, will be delivered from the beast and the beast system, as we see in Revelation 12. I'm getting there. Now, what does all this have to do with the 144,000? What we're going to learn is that It's the ministry of the 144,000 to lead the exiles back to the land during the tribulation period. And that their ministry is associated with Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles is also called the Season of Our Joy. That's based on Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 15, which says, "You shall surely rejoice at this feast." The Feast of Tabernacles is also associated with a harvest festival. And spiritually, the harvest of the God of Israel is His people being redeemed. Ultimately, they're redeemed and they come to Zion. During the tribulation period, they're redeemed from the nations of the world where they've been scattered. Now, there's a reference to the 144,000 in their ministry in the book of Obadiah. It's a short little book with only one chapter. And verse 15 tells us the setting. It's the day of the Lord, or the day of Yahweh, meaning the end of days before the Messianic kingdom. And then the last verse of Obadiah, verse 21, says, "Saviors shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the Mount of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's." The kingdom being the Lord's, that's a reference to Messiah setting up His kingdom. So notice the sequence here. What precedes Messiah setting up His kingdom is saviors coming up on Mount Zion. Now, the Hebrew word for saviors comes from the root word yesha, which means to free or to liberate. So the word saviors in this verse could also be accurately rendered as the liberators. Other Jewish writings say that among those liberators are those of the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom of Israel. Now in Revelation 14 verse 1, we see the 144,000 standing with the Lamb on Mount Zion. Why are they on Mount Zion? Because, again, the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel is associated with coming to Zion. And then in verse 2 of Revelation 14, we see that not only are they on Mount Zion, but they're also playing their harps. And the reason they're playing their harps is that playing of harps is associated with the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel. We see this in Psalm 137, beginning in verse 1. It says, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hung our harps upon the willows. They that carried us away captive required of us a song, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion." So while they were in exile in Babylon, they didn't play their harps. They hung on the willows. They couldn't play them because while they were there, the captors were mocking them and saying, "Sing us a song of Zion." And in verse 4, their response to this request is, "How shall we sing Yahweh's song in a strange land?" So the return to Zion will include being enabled to play a harp. That's why the 144,000 are not only on Mount Zion, but they'll be playing their harps and singing a new song. Mount Zion and the harps and a new song are all references to the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel. And their ministry is also associated with Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles. Revelation 7, verse 9, the first part says, "After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds or tribes and people and tongues." Of all nations. Of all nations. That's one of the themes of the Feast of Tabernacles. It's traditionally known as the Feast of Nations. This is because in God's instructions for the Feast of Tabernacles in Numbers chapter 29, verses 12 through 40, the children of Israel were told to sacrifice 13 bullocks the first day, 12 on the second day, 11 on the third day, and so on. And at the end of the week, a total of 70 bullocks would have been sacrificed. Now, the number 70 is traditionally associated with the number of nations in the earth after Noah's flood, corresponding to the 70 descendants of Noah's sons that are listed in Genesis chapter 10. Genesis 10 verse 32 says that the nations in the earth, when it gets repopulated after the flood, were divided according to the families of the sons of Noah. So the number of 70 nations also seems to be confirmed in other passages. Deuteronomy 32 verse 8, Genesis 46 verse 27, and Exodus chapter 1 verse 5. These passages seem to make a connection between the number of nations and the 70 members of Jacob's family that went down to Egypt. So, since 70 is the number of nations in the ancient world after the flood, and 70 bullocks were sacrificed at the Feast of Tabernacles, that's why it's also known as the Feast of Nations or the Feast of All Nations. And we have an allusion to that, or a reference to that, here in Revelation 7, verse 9. Then there's a question that is asked in Revelation 7, verse 13. One of the elders answered, saying unto me, this is John speaking, the elders said, "Who are these which are arrayed in white robes, and from where did they come?" The elders are asking John. Verse 14 continues, "I said unto him, Sir, you know." In other words, beats me. I don't have any idea. "And he said to me, These are they who came out of great tribulation." Then the Bible goes on to describe these who come out of the great tribulation in verses 16 and 17, saying, "They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes." What we may not know is that these words are quoting and paraphrasing Isaiah chapter 49, verse 10. Let's look at that. It says, "They shall not hunger nor thirst, neither shall the heat nor sun smite them. For he that has mercy on them shall lead them, even by the springs of water shall he guide them." Now, what's the context of this verse in Isaiah? Well, we see the context in verse 6 of chapter 49. Says, "You should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel." The subject is gathering the 12 tribes of Israel. And in verse 9, he is to tell the prisoners to go forth. The prisoners are the exiles of Israel. Going forth is the end of the exile. So Isaiah 49:10 is saying this about these prisoners who are to go forth. "They will not hunger nor thirst, neither will the heat nor the sun smite them. For he that has mercy on them shall lead them, even by springs of water shall he guide them." And this is the verse that is quoted in Revelation 7, verses 16 and 17, as the answer to the question in verse 13, which was, "Who are these who are arrayed in white, and where do they come from?" They're the ones who come out of the great tribulation, and they are the end times ingathering of the 12 tribes of Israel from all over the world who are protected during this time. And the 144,000 are participating in this gathering, along with Yeshua and his angels, playing the role that Moses played in the first Exodus. I want to look at Jeremiah 16 one more time, and this time I'll add another verse to illustrate this. beginning in verse 14. He says, "Therefore, behold, the days come, says Yahweh, that it shall no more be said, Yahweh lives that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but Yahweh lives that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the lands where he had driven them, and I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers. Behold, I will send for many fishers, says Yahweh, and they shall fish them. And after will I send for many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain and from every hill and out of the holes of the rocks." So one reason that we're told about the 144,000 in the book of Revelation is because they participate in playing the role of being the leaders to help find and gather the exiles of Israel back to the land. It seems that the 140,000 or 144,000 will be involved in ministry to the exiles during the Great Tribulation, before the wedding of the Lamb, and in leading them back to the Promised Land. Now I want to close by looking one more time at the order of the names of the 12 tribes of Israel that are in verses 5 through 8 of Revelation 7, along with their corresponding Hebrew meanings. Each one of those tribal names has a meaning. And I'm going to show you the list of the names and the meanings and where it comes from. Now, here's the amazing part. If we make a sentence out of the meanings and the order that they are listed in Revelation 7, it forms a remarkable statement. I will praise Yahweh, for he has looked on me, or on my affliction, and has granted me good fortune. I am happy because my wrestling, God is making me to forget. God hears me and is joined to me. He has purchased me a dwelling and will add to me the son of his right hand. Awesome. Hallelujah. These names presented in this order in Revelation 7 seem to describe the bride of Messiah and the complete story of him marrying his bride after delivering her from her affliction, summarizing the believer's struggle, redemption, victory, and ultimate marriage to the Lamb. Maybe this is a special message of encouragement for those who are faithful, obedient believers in Yeshua, no matter what their physical ancestry is. Well, hallelujah to the Lamb for what he has done for us.